Good morning and a very warm welcome to the 14th meeting of the Constitution, Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee and our first virtual committee meeting in this session of the Parliament. We have two agenda items this morning. Our first agenda item is our inquiry into the UK internal market. And this morning we have joining us Johnny Hall, Director of Policy, National Farmer Unions of Scotland, and a very good morning, Mr. Hall. And thank you very much for your written submission to the committee as well. We're going to move straight to questions from the committee, and if I could open with a question about kind of the history and development of the NFU's involvement in the internal market. I notice in your submission you emphasise how important the option to have divergence is to the NFU to meet the needs of the individual nations and to protect particular aspects of farming. But you also mentioned that the principles of mutual recognition and non-discrimination are seen as a threat to that opportunity. So it's really just to understand the history of what involvement the NFU had in the development of the policies before the bill was introduced, and at what point did you start to see the opportunity to diverge in particular areas becoming a problem?
Oh, well, thank you, Convener. Yes, that's a very broad question indeed, and I'll try and be brief, but also as concise as I can be. Obviously, our interest in this goes back to the whole point at which the EU referendum took place, because obviously once that happened in 2016 and we realised that we were going to be leaving the EU, obviously that meant leaving the European single market and the challenges that that would bring, and obviously that's maybe a different discussion for a different day. But leaving the EU also meant leaving that overarching single market approach that we enjoyed within the EU, whereby essentially all member states, including devolved administrations within the UK, enjoyed a certain amount of flexibility, but still essentially complied with the same regulatory frameworks and the same support frameworks. And I'm particularly talking about the Common Agricultural Policy, whereby a Common Agricultural Policy over the EU essentially allowed for member states and Scotland to adapt within that certain aspects to suit devolved circumstances. But behind the CAP, there's then a whole raft of environmental, animal health and welfare, food and other legislation that was European legislation, and essentially all the players within Europe played to the same rules, to put it as simply as that. So effectively we all played the same game at very least, not necessarily always on a level playing field, but we all played the same game with the same rules around very important things. You then fast forward to the summer of 2020, and Westminster obviously recognized the challenges of devolved approaches and diverging regulatory approaches and the potential impact that might have on the internal market and the integrity of the internal market. And we, of course, would share those concerns because we obviously want the internal UK market to operate essentially as it has done recently and still does now, essentially. But in a sense, what the consultation on the UK Internal Market Act or Bill, as at the time, did, and then the Act that then followed pretty rapidly this time last year, it largely, and I'll use the expression, drove something of a coach and horses through the whole concept and philosophy around devolved capacity in certain areas. And we'd always argued, and as had others, and as had been the case through the JMCC and so on, that actually an awful lot of these issues didn't require this sort of legislation. if we could have constituted effective common frameworks, which were discussed, you know, through the 2017, 18, 19 period, whereby the devolved administrations, including the UK government representing England, if you like, would essentially agree things by consensus rather than by having, as I say, that sort of what I might describe as the sledgehammer to crack the walnut of a UK internal market act. So whilst that hasn't necessarily been borne out in reality in terms of particular issues, there is still huge potential for that to cause potential problems for the internal market. And the reason why I say that, the reason why the flag waves for me, is that on the one hand, we certainly have a UK government which is starting to test the boundaries of diverging from the EU. At the same time, we have the Scottish government remaining pretty much aligned to the EU, especially on environmental regulation and other things as well. And that's borne out by the Continuity Act, which was passed by the Scottish Parliament quite recently, and that whole notion of keeping pace with Europe. And I'm still trying to square the triangle, if that makes sense, of Westminster, Edinburgh, and Brussels, and where that then leaves the likes of Scottish agriculture and food producers operating within a single market within the UK. And maybe I can go into that further at some point. So that is a very, very much a snapshot of our history in this and how important it is. And I hope in the written submission, I did make it very, very clear that the UK internal market is really, really important to the interests of Scottish agriculture and Scottish food production. It is less so for England, but for the devolved administrations with smaller populations, our market is south of the border, essentially, for so many things. And therefore, it matters, and it matters that we maintain that level playing field, and not only that level playing field, but we essentially play to the same rules. And if we start to see divergence in those rules, that then can create a competitive advantage or disadvantage, depending on which way those rules go. And we are just starting to see some testing of those boundaries, and that will not only create some political headaches, but it will create practical and potentially market distorting headaches for Scottish agriculture.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm going to move to questions from the committee members, and could I invite Sarah Boyack first, please?
Thanks very much, Convener. And can I thank you, Mr. Hall, for the written paper that you've sent us in advance, which is actually very useful. And I really want to follow on from the comments you've just made. You've said in your written submission that you see a major challenge in terms of how things are developing, but that you think that common frameworks would be a much more effective alternative to manage divergence, which would enable respecting devolution and enabling the UK internal market to operate without friction or distortion. Can you say a bit about the discussions that you've had collectively across the four nations of the UK on the farming side, and what discussions you've had with the different governments to actually get across that view?
Yes, you know, our colleagues at NFU in England and in Wales, and our colleagues within the Ulster Farmers Union, we've been absolutely consistent and as one about the fact that we all agreed that common frameworks would be a more preferential approach, whereby things if you like, resolved through consensus rather than imposition, and rather than that, the elements of the UK Internal Market Act, particularly the mutual recognition and non-discrimination elements. And we've always argued that common frameworks, if constituted correctly, would allow for dispute resolution and or allow for things to be resolved in a more constructive way, and therefore common frameworks will always appear to be the more pragmatic and effective approach to safeguarding the integrity of the UK internal market, which we all want. And that appeared to be very much the case in the early days in 2017-18. There was a lot of work going on behind the scenes with Scottish Government, I know, and colleagues within Westminster and the other devolved administrations, try and work up effective common frameworks and how they could be governed and how it could be ensured that where there was dispute resolution, that could be done in a meaningful way. But essentially, I haven't been entirely cited on this because obviously it's been done by governments and officials from those governments and overseen by the Joint Ministerial Committee. But essentially, we haven't really seen that roll out into any sort of practical evidence of that working in operation. And along has come in 2021, the UK Internal Market Act, which almost sort of, as I said earlier, sort of drives a coach and horses through the principles of common frameworks and almost renders them, you know, redundant, because if you operate on those principles of non-discrimination and mutual recognition, it doesn't really matter how or through what methods and means something might be produced in one part of the UK. It has to be allowed access to other parts of the UK in terms of being sold or used or whatever it might be. So the common frameworks principles are absolutely where we still want to be, but that seems to have been, you know, almost lost now because of the UK Internal Market Act and what that then means in terms of the fact that something that might be produced in, let's say, in a part of England that is then sold in Scotland, but it's produced to very different standards at different cost structures that might afford English producers an advantage, or indeed at some sort of environmental difference or whatever it might be, then there's no comeback on that. There's no dispute resolution on that. That, because of the UK Internal Market Act, that has to be just you know, absorbed and taken in. And that then, in a sense, doesn't allow for that devolved capacity to really work effectively.
So have you been able to actually have those discussions with ministers to actually get that point across? Because it comes across very strongly in your written evidence that that approach will undermine agricultural support, environment, animal welfare standards and food. And that's the key point that comes across. And you say you're nervous about potential dispute resolution. What is the reality check without common frameworks and without ministers actually bringing people together and actually negotiating this?
The reality is that there will be very little option for dispute resolution, in my opinion, because that legislation is now in place, which now covers the whole of the United Kingdom. You know, we have raised this along with our other farming unions on several occasions with the UK government. We've worked reasonably closely with the Scottish government at trying to press the case for common frameworks across whole areas, whether it's organic standards, environmental standards around pesticide use, food labelling, food safety issues, animal health and welfare issues. There's a whole raft of issues that were EU law, now transposed back into UK and Scots law, that should be allowed for some sort of degree of flexibility and on a devolved sense. But now, essentially, that's almost secondary to the fact that the UK Internal Market Act will, as I say, drive a coach and horses through that idea. So we continue to press the case. For example, there is a so-called grouping that DEFRA have set up around agricultural support frameworks, which is meant to bring together the devolved administrations, including key stakeholders like ourselves, as well as Scottish Government, to look at how agriculture is supported in different parts of the United Kingdom, to ensure that there's no significant divergence in that affords a competitive advantage or disadvantage. Because obviously, quite rightly, England, Wales, Scotland and Northern Ireland are all doing different things, essentially, because of the different circumstances and profiles of different agriculture. But we're all on that same pathway to sort of recognising that agriculture is now about food, climate change, biodiversity and so on. But we need to do it in a different way, because what will suit England with its very different profile of agriculture will not suit Scotland and vice versa. But there is an agricultural framework that exists, but it's at the moment it seems to be nothing more than a talking shop. In fact, that actually hasn't met yet, despite us pressing for this to be up and running, so that actually both governments and key stakeholders can feed into that process, so that we're all aware of what's happening, so that we can basically work on towards the same end goals in many ways, but do it in different ways. And that's the whole point of devolution.
Yes, that comes across very strongly, that you need the common frameworks, but even at the very basic level, just actually getting the meetings going on things like the agricultural framework, that's really helpful. I think clear evidence does today. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Can I invite Dr. Allen, please?
Hi, good morning, and welcome to the committee. You mentioned there the issues that you have raised around the Internal Market Act. And I notice in your written evidence, Mr. Hall, you say NFU Scotland remains significantly concerned that the Act could potentially override all common frameworks, as you've just talked about just now, relating to agricultural support, environmental and specifically animal welfare standards. So I'm interested to know, particularly on that issue of animal welfare standards and the production of meat, if you can give any examples of how you feel your concerns might be made manifest, or what kind of situations you think might arise.
I'm not here today to sort of say that something will absolutely happen as a consequence of this. You know, I'm not saying that we will end up with very, very differing animal health and welfare standards across the United Kingdom. But there is the potential, and we're already seeing the potential, to have different sets of regulations within the United Kingdom around certain things. Now, the obvious example of that is the fact that the UK government, through DEFRA, have already consulted on animal transport, and so has the Scottish government also consulted on animal transport regulations. Now, the likelihood is that those sets of regulations will align pretty closely. But the issue is that there might be some differences of approach depending on circumstance. Now, you know, we could end up the situation whereby we have two sets of regulations governing what is the UK internal market, and we have animal transport, which doesn't really respect the fact that there is a boundary between Scotland and England, because there is a need for livestock to be transported both north and south of that border. Nor might there be, if there's a UK approach to animal transport, will that adequately reflect some of the challenges and circumstances that we find ourselves in the Scottish context? So we've got members in Orkney and Shetland, for example, who are extremely concerned by anything that might be imposed on them that might make practical common sense in the south of England. But when it comes to the islands and the highlands of Scotland, might be extremely limiting in terms of what they can do, in terms of journey times, etc., and the other issues that need to be resolved. And it all seems a bit exacting when we were already operating to a significantly high set of standards in terms of things like animal transport under the EU rules. So, you know, without going into any great detail and saying this will definitely happen, the fact of the matter is that we now have the ability of different devolved administrations setting different rules, and those different rules could start to diverge, especially, as I said earlier, if the UK government wants to test the boundaries of divergence from Europe, because after all that was one of the rationales of leaving Europe in the first place, and the Scottish government, as it's already stated on a number of occasions through the Continuity Act, wants to keep pace with Europe. So where does that leave producers in both in terms of animal welfare and other regulatory requirements?
Yeah, you've asked my next question, which is where does that leave the agriculture industry? I mean, in that scenario, in the scenario where the Internal Market Act would oblige everyone to make available and again use the example of meat, but meat produced to different welfare standards in England oblige that to be made available on the market in Scotland. How would that affect, though, farmers who are endeavouring to use a different standard in Scotland, and what would the reaction of the market, particularly the supermarkets, be to that situation in Scotland?
There's two components here. There's a sort of what's right, particularly when you're talking about animal welfare. What's right in terms of welfare is one thing, but there's also what are the cost implications on the business of adhering to those requirements. So first of all is that animal welfare has to be at the most exacting and correct standards. But if we operate at a high standard in Scotland and continue to do so, but we see, let's say, and this is, for example, this is hypothetical at the moment, this is not necessarily what's going to happen. If we see a different standard, at a lower standard being set within the rest of the United Kingdom or particularly in England, that lower standard would probably mean a lower cost in terms of compliance, because compliance brings additional costs in terms of adhering to those standards. And that then means that a producer in Berwickshire, for example, producing beef compared to somebody in Northumberland would have different cost structures. And it wouldn't just apply to meat production or animal livestock production. It would apply to lots of other things as well, in terms of we would start to see different regulatory frameworks demanding different management from different producers in different parts of the UK, which then would demand different costs in terms of production. So whilst we would obviously argue that the Scottish product will sell at a premium anyway because of the high standards that we have, nevertheless, those high the margin of that high standard could be easily eroded if we also have escalating costs in terms of maintaining those standards. Or not necessarily escalating costs, but higher costs than other parts of the United Kingdom.
You've also pointed to the fact that this model of legislating doesn't have any obvious or doesn't have any dispute resolution mechanism within it. Can you say a bit more about what the consequences of that lack are?
Well, I think that's why we would obviously prefer the common frameworks approach, because if common frameworks were established and constituted in the right way, so there was proper dispute resolution processes in place, then when you had these sort of tensions arise, then there would be a process to go through to get to that point of resolution, rather than what we've got now, which is the UK Internal Market Act, which, as you said yourself, because of the very nature of that, the provisions within the Act, there is nothing to prevent something produced at a different standard or to a different set of regulations, and therefore at a different cost, being sold or used in Scotland to either the advantage or disadvantage of Scottish agriculture, or indeed not necessarily to the knowledge of the Scottish consumer.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Can I invite Mr. Golden, please?
Thank you, convener. Just to continue the kind of theme of questioning, Johnny, clearly through the Continuity Act, the Scottish Government's stated position is that the default is to align with new EU laws as they're introduced. Given this could cause divergence, how concerned are you regarding the impact of the Continuity Act on ensuring a level playing field across the UK?
Well, yeah, concerned indeed, because as I said earlier in my introductory remarks, following the convener's initial question, is that how do you square the triangle whereby you've got a Westminster government that is clearly starting to test and probe that ability to diverge away from what the EU are doing, but still maintain that trade with Europe through the Trade and Cooperation Agreement. But you've also got on the other side, you here in Scotland, we've got a Scottish government which is clearly committed to keeping pace with, and that's the expression they use, regulation from Europe, and therefore that suggests to me straight away that you're going to start to see that tension between the UK government and the Scottish government, and I think we probably are, and that gives me as much concern about the potential impacts of the UK Internal Market Act, but it, almost in the reverse, in that it's the reciprocal of that in some ways, because you know I'll give another potential example on that. I can see the situation whereby Europe might ban the use of a product called glyphosate, which is used in agriculture as a desiccant, essentially, in the cereal sector, but also in grassland to burn off grass to be reseeded, et cetera, et cetera. And in that sense, has some significant environmental benefits because it provides for minimum tillage when you're re-sowing grass and so on. But I won't go into the detail of that. But Europe is clearly quite keen to move in that direction, where glyphosate isn't such a big issue because they don't have the climate that we have, and they don't have the use that we need for using things like glyphosate in order to ripen crops to then harvest them on time, etc., etc. Now, if the EU goes in that direction, and Scotland then follows suit, but England chooses not to, again, using the Northumberland and Berwickshire example, grain produced in Northumberland that uses glyphosate to ripen it off, but not allowed in Berwickshire, that's a significant and obvious clear competitive disadvantage between people operating on both sides of the Tweed, or on either side of the Tweed, I should say. And yet, that's again where the UK Internal Market Act would kick in and say that grain produced in Northumberland would have to have access into Scottish markets. And the Scottish whisky industry does use a significant amount of grain from Northumberland and other parts of England as well. It's not all Scottish stuff going into distilling in Scotland because we can't grow enough of it. So that would come in, produced at a different cost structure from the grain produced in Scotland. And therefore, that would be a disadvantage. So that triangle issue that I've mentioned a couple of times, I think it's yet to be really tested and rolled out in practice. But I can see that being really quite damaging as Scottish agriculture and the food and drink sector gets caught in that sort of those tensions of divergence in three ways. As Scotland aligns itself to Europe, but as the UK tries to diverge from Europe, but then in comes the UK Internal Market Act to basically quash any differences there as well.
Thanks, Johnny. And I think on the glyphosate example, I think that's very useful because it's perhaps the highest up on the risk register in terms of the implications of the Continuity Act. Just as a follow-up on common frameworks, I'm keen to hear your thoughts on what would be the consequences if the Scottish Government did not sign up to the common framework.
I'm not 100% sure what the consequence would be, given that we've now got the UK Internal Market Act. My understanding, having had conversations with officials from Scottish Government, is that they would want to see common frameworks work just as we would. They see, because again, common frameworks essentially respect that devolved capacity to make devolved decisions, but when they're there, those devolved decisions across the United Kingdom can cause some sort of tension or potential trade distortion or competitive advantage, disadvantage, then that's when the common frameworks processes around dispute resolution need to kick in. So I don't see any resistance from Scottish Government about utilising common frameworks more effectively, and we would be in exactly the same place in that respect. As I say, the reality is that we've got now is that the work that was happening around common frameworks through that 2017, 18, 19 period has now been, as I say, kind of almost been made redundant by the fact that we've got the UK Internal Market Act, which almost renders common frameworks useless.
Thank you, Johnny. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Could I invite Ms. Minto, please?
Thank you. Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Mr. Hall, for submitting your evidence. I'd like to turn to one point that you made, and you've already touched on it with regards to Ms. Boyack's question. You state that agricultural support arrangements are currently and must remain devolved. You talked about the agricultural support framework across the UK that is yet to meet. So I'm interested to get your thoughts on the subsidy control bill that's currently passing through. Well, it's passed through Westminster and it's now in the House of Lords.
Yeah, I think that's a very valid point, because obviously the UK Internal Market Act and now the what will be the subsidy control bill actually overlap and interrelate really quite significantly when it comes to the agricultural support element. And if you'll just bear with me for a second, obviously under the CAP we had four different versions of the CAP operating within the United Kingdom, but all still operating under that common agricultural policy from Europe. And that was absolutely right, so that we took choices here in Scotland which were right for Scotland. For example, we have some elements of coupled support for our beef and hill sheep. We have a less favoured area support payment, which other parts of the United Kingdom don't, and so on. And obviously since then, we're still obviously going through a process of still operating those schemes by and large. But we're seeing that in England in particular, the English approach is to phase out direct support payments over the 20 to 27 period and introduce called the Environmental Land Management Scheme, which is just starting to kick off now. So there'll be a phasing out of direct support payments and an introduction of an agri-environment scheme to meet or to achieve outcomes that DEFRA want to achieve in England. And that's fine. If we took an ELMS type approach in Scotland, i.e. we phased out direct support and things like less favoured area support for our more disadvantaged areas, then that would be almost the death knell of Scottish agriculture. What we're doing in Scotland, and quite rightly so, is starting to look at conditional payments rather than just area-based payments. And I won't go into the detail of all this. We are going to change our agricultural policy, and that's absolutely necessary. We do need to change, but we do not need to change in a way that DEFRA are doing it. So my concern around, to get to the point of your question, my concern is that with the Subsidy Control Bill coming into place, as well as the UK Internal Market Act, I'm convinced that certain producers, it won't be long before certain agricultural producers in England who are more aligned to the type of agriculture we have in Scotland, i.e. people in Northumberland, Cumbria, down the Pennines in the West Country, more livestock-based, a bit more like Scotland in terms of the types of agriculture, they will see the support payments and the way Scottish Government is underpinning and deriving new outcomes from Scottish agriculture as being more advantageous to what they're being given from DEFRA. And I'm pretty sure that before very long, there'll be a real kickback from farmers in England to say, you know, we really cannot sustain these cuts in our support payments. And rather than just having that argument with DEFRA, they'll say, but Scotland is still doing that. Scotland is still underpinning farmers and crofters to deliver certain things, and they're doing it in a way that actually works with agricultural businesses. And my concern about the Subsidy Control Bill is that it can then be used as something of a tool to say, actually, Scottish Government, you've got to stop giving this type of support to farmers and crofters in Scotland, because it's not the same type of support being received in other parts of the United Kingdom, and it's affording Scottish farmers an advantage. Now, to me, that again would say, well, all of a sudden you're taking that ability to apply devolved policy away from the Scottish Government if that were the case. And I also think, sticking on the Subsidy Control Bill, there are already existing international safeguards in place to ensure that we don't overload payments to Scottish farmers in any way. We have something called the Agreement on Agriculture under the WTO, et cetera, et cetera. So and we're never going to have a big enough budget to overly support farmers and crofters in Scotland, the extent that they have an incredible advantage over producers in other parts of the UK. But again, you've highlighted an issue of concern, that at what point does that become an issue that legislation will be very binary about it, it'll either say it's right or wrong, whereas common frameworks would have allowed for some sort of adjudication and some consensus to be built around what's required in different parts of the United Kingdom.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hall, for that very detailed response. I'd also like to pick up on one of the points that you made with regard to Scottish public bodies looking to procure locally, and why you think the current structure of the UK Internal Market Act may impact on that.
Yeah, well, obviously, public procurement is a hangover from EU legislation in many ways, but obviously the Scottish Parliament and the programme for government, we want to revisit the whole issue around a good food nation, as part of that, and I wouldn't want to preempt what might be in a good food nation bill and what the outcomes might be, but as part of that you would think that some of that might be about local procurement, public bodies being able to, if not quite obliged, to buy locally, i.e. buy Scottish produce to put into Scottish schools, Scottish health service, Scottish prisons, whatever it might be, so that we have that almost circular economy piece happening around food and so on. Again, the Internal Market Act, that I think there's a risk that whilst we might have that piece of legislation or that intention in Scotland to buy local, that non-discrimination element of the Internal Market Act might say that actually you can't do that. You've simply got to allow product based on price or whatever it might be to have access to, or to be allowed to compete in the markets for public procurement, rather than being exclusive about it, which again, that's the, we think we need to put in place measures that allow, or not only allow, but almost compel public bodies in Scotland to buy Scottish produce.
Great. Thank you very much for your answers, Mr. Hull, and thank you, convener.
Thank you. Can I invite Mr. Ruskell, please?
Yeah, thanks, convener, and good to see you again, Mr. Hull. I wanted just to drill down into a couple of issues. You're mentioning about the animal transport issue earlier on. And I suppose if I was to be provocative here, I could say that the NFUS position on this is to argue for weaker live animal transport regulations compared to what DEFRA is proposing. I mean, notwithstanding the geographical challenges that you outlined earlier on. So I suppose the question here is about how in that situation you might actually use the Internal Market Act to effectively allow continued access or to even challenge regulations that you see as undermining the needs and the interests of your members.
I'm slightly taken aback by the suggestion that we would seek legislation that would be lower than the DEFRA proposals. I don't believe that's the case at all. We want to be able to operate to the highest standards, because I think our customers ultimately respect the standards to which we produce food here in Scotland. On the issues that would separate or differentiate between the proposals from DEFRA and the proposals from the Scottish Government, you touched on it yourself in that one of the main objectives of the DEFRA proposals is to certainly around animal exports, and that's one thing. But what we're talking about isn't necessarily animal exports, it's about animals travelling within the UK. And you also touched on the fact that our geography, especially from the islands, does mean that we have to have more scope for longer journey times, given the lack of processing capacity and other things within Scotland. So that whether you're talking about beef cattle, sheep, pigs, poultry, They do necessarily have to spend longer times in transit to get either to destinations for to be store animals, i.e. for further breeding or whatever it might be, or to go to be processed. And therefore, I think it's important that we don't get sucked into legislation that might be suited to shorter journeys in the southeast of England, or indeed export issues from the southeast England to the continent, when those journey times are obviously greater and more significant when even moving animals within Scotland. So I think that's where we need to be pretty careful about these things.
Yes, but if your starting point is about high standards and your starting point is about high welfare standards for animals, does it really matter which stretch of water the animals are being transported and on which roads? It's about the length of journey time. So I suppose my point is that I understand the geographic case, and I think, you know, you pointed yourself to the need to increase supply chain development, mobile abattoirs, maybe local branding from the islands as well. So that, you know, there are other ways to crack this. And I do understand the argument that your members put forward. But I suppose within the context of this, that's an area where there's a challenge, right? There's a different perspective coming from the NFUS. And how might you use the Internal Market Act to really, and perhaps the common frameworks as well, to really sort of challenge those rules, if that's something you did want to challenge on?
Well, again, I think, you know, just going to the point about it isn't just about journey times, it's the ways in which animals are transported, not necessarily the journey time, and it's about headroom, and it's about temperature, and it's about spacing, and it's about stoppage times and all that. So, but that's another issue. So, you know, we're not seeking to erode any of those issues. Let's not measure everything in journey times. The way in which we would want to identify with DEFRA around this more than anything else is about having at least a uniform standard across the United Kingdom that is practical and effective, but retains a very high animal health and welfare standard whilst animals are in transit. And in that sense, again, it goes back to the comments I've made a number of times, is that we need to be able to operate to a single set of regulation across the United Kingdom, across the internal market of the UK. Otherwise, we do start to see differences in standards, and difference in standards start to impose different sorts of costs. I suspect that if we ended up with very limited capacity in terms of journey time on certain trips from, say, Shetland, Orkney, from Islay, let alone other parts of mainland Scotland, then it would be pretty much the death knell of livestock in those areas. And the consequence of that would be hugely impactful on both economically and socially in those areas.
Okay, I mean, I suppose the question here then is about, I mean, you described the triangle, because, you know, there's alignment with EU, there's alignment with UK, and the Scottish regulations as well. I mean, I suppose, being provocative here again, but is there not an advantage to you in a way within that, in that you can argue for alignment in some areas and then argue for divergence in other areas? So it enables you to kind of pick and choose. So the point about glyphosate, again, you make a particular argument for that. And I don't want to get into the details of whether you know, the pros and cons of that as an option, but in a way you're able to kind of move around these different regulatory frameworks and kind of position yourselves and your members in terms of saying, okay, here we've got high standards, here we've got alignment, but here we actually don't agree with it. So are there some advantages to that, or is it still, are you still trying to get used to the landscape now that you're in, where it's quite fluid and common frameworks aren't really working properly yet? And
well, I think the whole point is that, you know, and I've said it a few times, is that actually the UK Internal Market Act drives a coach and horses through that ability to align in some ways and not be aligned in others. So that then removes that ability to do things in a differentiated and devolved way. because whilst we might align ourselves with Europe on some things, or align ourselves with the UK or other parts of the UK on other things, as soon as you've got that UK Internal Market Act in place, then that renders that all irrelevant. So Scotland might align itself with Europe on glyphosate. Let's say the rest of the UK doesn't, but the UK Internal Market Act then says it doesn't matter. Scottish distillers will still have to be obliged to take grain or use grain that has been used with glyphosate. That puts Scottish agricultural producers at a disadvantage.
I suppose my final question then is just, I mean, obviously as a member organisation, trade body, you know, you've engaged a lot with Europe over the years. I'm just wondering what that engagement looks like now. And also, you know, are there lessons from other kind of regions across Europe as well? So I'm thinking about the Nordic regions, about how, you know, they effectively align their markets. Because I suppose there you've got complications. You've got Norway that's outside the EU, you've got Sweden that's in. You know, there'll be issues there around trade of food, trade of livestock, maybe, and other products. But are there any sort of examples from your international experience about how alignment market regulation can work between countries that are sitting in very different constitutional arrangements than we are here sitting in post-Brexit UK?
Well, to touch on your first point, yeah, we still absolutely have a very keen interest in what's happening in Europe and how we align ourselves to Europe. So we still have an office in Brussels that we share with the other farming unions in the UK called the British Agricultural Bureau. We still have full-time staff there because clearly we still need to engage with Europe, not only in terms of how regulation and policy develops within Europe and what the implications might be of that, but equally in terms of the outcome, if you like, of the trade and cooperation agreement, which obviously is tariff-free access to the European markets for us. It's quota-free access, but it's far from friction-free. So it's about how do we resolve some of the ongoing issues around trade and cooperation agreement, and things like the movement of people, and that's back to things like the Home Office and so on. So there's a whole raft of things that are still very much in that Brexit hangover, if I can call it that. So, and that still needs to settle down, that we still need to really understand how trade flows will work effectively going forward. We have asymmetric trade with Europe at the moment, so anything can come in to the UK pretty much friction-free without check from Europe, but our products going to Europe are still having to go through very cumbersome checks and all sorts of things like this. So we still need to work all those things through. So, you know, I think it's going to be an interesting few years, to be honest, before it really, really settles down as to what the operating environment really is for UK and Scottish agriculture with the rest of Europe. And whether we settle into that pattern of being a bit like Norway. But obviously, we're not the same as Norway because Norway are part of a different alignment to Europe than we've got this very bespoke agreement with Europe. So, there's a lot to play out, really, in many ways.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you. Can I invite Mr. Cameron, please?
Thank you, Convener. And good morning, Mr. Hall. Good to see you. A lot of my points have been covered already by other questions. Can I just ask you generally about common frameworks? You said a number of times that you view the Internal Market Act as having driven a coach and horses through them. Do you think there's any future for common frameworks? It strikes me that whilst they're still in their infancy, and whilst there aren't that many that are operational, there is still a possibility for them to work. Scottish Parliament has scrutinised several of them already. Do you see that there is a future for them, notwithstanding your comments?
Yes, I do, and I seriously believe that actually I think that's where you know, the farming unions as well across the United Kingdom, as well as the devolved administration, still have an awful lot of work to do collectively to sort of say, where can we recognise the degrees of flexibility required in different ways for different agriculture and food systems within the UK internal market, and where can we almost find common cause about finding common solutions that work effectively, and where can we share information as much as anything else. So I still see a real value in having common frameworks whereby the sort of policy discussion about what type of regulatory environment we should be operating in, what support environment we should be operating in, is still very, very important, so that we can all be mindful and respectful of what's happening in other parts of the United Kingdom. You know, I'll go back to the whole issue of agricultural support. It's absolutely vital that the Scottish Government is able to continue to support Scottish farmers and crofters in a way that's most appropriate for Scottish circumstances to deliver the outcomes we want around food production, climate, biodiversity, and so on. But that's going to be very different, as I say, from how other parts of the United Kingdom will approach that. But sharing some of that, I think, is also really important as well. And so that there's almost like a mutual respect as to why these things happen. So that, you know, that ultimately, if we got that right in the first place, then any real potential issues that might be thrown up by the operation of the UK Internal Market Act might become relatively insignificant.
Thank you for that. And I think, as we all acknowledge, the UK Internal Market Act we haven't seen its sort of practical effect yet, if at all. Can I specifically concentrate on agricultural support? And convener, can I also at this point refer to my register of interest in terms of crofting and farming? The Scottish Government's stated intention, as you've said already, is to keep pace with EU law. And I suppose what I'm asking you is, could you foresee a situation where, specifically in terms of agricultural support, Scottish Government's policy is more aligned with you know, the common agricultural policy and EU subsidy law, whereas another nation of the UK, for example, Wales or Northern Ireland, has a different subsidy system? Can you foresee any issues in that regard, in terms of the kind of Internal Markets Act and what we've spoken about already?
Yes, I can. I mean, I can see lots of potentials, and let's just emphasise the point that they are potentials. I'm not suggesting that they are particularly risks at this moment in time. What I do see is a Scottish Government, I think, taking a very much the pragmatic approach in terms of leaving the common agricultural policy. So essentially, we've got a period of stability whereby we've retained many elements of the common agricultural policy, but we're now developing a future policy through a new agriculture bill, which will come to the Scottish Parliament in 2023, and so on, which will essentially implement the Scottish Government's proposal around 50% of support payments being conditional on meeting outcomes around biodiversity and climate and so on. And we're 100% behind that. That's a very different pace of change and a very much a managed change that we would welcome. Other parts of the United Kingdom are doing their own thing as well. Now, your point, Donald, about alignment with the EU is that the EU are also going through a process of agricultural policy reform right now. So on that 7-year cycle that the EU operates, they're just completing another round of CAP reform. Now my view is that if we just picked up and pasted into Scotland what the EU are currently doing in terms of agricultural policy, then I think that would be extremely detrimental to Scotland, because I think it would stretch agricultural businesses to breaking point in many senses. It would not be reflective of what we actually need in Scotland in terms of underpinning active farming and crofting to then deliver the outcomes that we want. It wouldn't particularly suit Scottish circumstances, and not least in the west coast of Scotland, when we've got much more extensive agricultural systems on large holdings, etc. So it's one of those situations whereby that would be a point where I would say actually keeping pace with Europe could be extremely detrimental if we just cut and pasted what was happening in Europe and put that into agricultural policy in Scotland. So it's one of those where I would say to the Scottish Government, yes, we hear what you're saying in terms of keeping alignment and keeping pace with Europe, but on that particular one, you need to be doing something that's far more bespoke to Scotland's needs, and you need to be sticking to a track that you've already set out to achieve. Because if we simply duplicated the new common agricultural policy and imposed that on Scotland, I could see that being very detrimental to Scottish interests. And I'm not just talking Scottish agricultural interests, I'm talking about Scotland's interests.
Thank you for that very full answer. My final question is just about the Subsidy Control Bill, which I think Jenny Minto was asking you about. And I understand it's going through the UK Parliament at the moment. Are there any particular provisions that you're concerned about in terms of threatening the ability of any devolved nation to design its own support system? I'm not fully conversant with the legislation, so.
Well, essentially, NFU Scotland, along with the other farming unions, argued very strongly in the first place that agricultural support should not be part of the Subsidy Control Bill anyway, because there are enough existing controls in not overloading payments in one way or another through things like the WTO agreement on agriculture and so on. So, but yes, a bit like the UK Internal Market Act, it does now have the potential to say, as I say, we have an element of coupled support in Scotland for our beef and hill sheep producers, particularly those hill sheep producers on the poorest quality of land. If the Subsidy Control Bill allowed for the essentially coupled support to be removed, then we would lose that ability. We would lose that option, if you like, in Scotland to retain that element of support going forward. And therefore, again, a bit like the UK Internal Market Act, it's the potential that this might create to undermine Scotland's ability to do what's right for Scotland by creating a one-size-fits-all, if you like, approach. And that's my concern on this, about what you can support and what you can't support. Now, you know, we're the first to say that we need to move away from area-based payments, and we need to move to payments that are based on delivering outcomes. But at the same time, as you know from your constituency in your part of the world, if we simply removed direct support overnight, then it would be, last one out, turn the lights off, please. And it remains vital to the social economic fabric of many parts of Scotland that we continue to support farmers and crofters to a degree in the way that we do now, but start to shift that to delivering outcomes rather than simply based on area payments.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Mr. Hall, if I could ask another follow-up question on glyphosate and discussion we've had so far. So it was given as an example of where the keeping pace powers would be of concern to you, but of course the keeping pace powers have been committed to by the Welsh Government as well, and the nature of that Northern Irish Protocol is that, you know, anything from Europe would be implemented in Northern Ireland. So is it not more likely that the divergence at the moment would be not between Scotland and the rest of the UK, but actually between England and, you know, the other three devolved nations? And that's in the context of the shared work that you were talking about in your office in Brussels with your counterparts in the other countries.
Yeah, I would agree with that. You know, England has by far and away the biggest agricultural base in the United Kingdom, but it also has the biggest market. And as I said earlier, our market essentially is England, by and large. It's certainly our biggest destination. And I think I put some figures in my written submission that, you know, the internal UK market is far more important to Scotland and to Wales and to Northern Ireland than it is to England, because the internal market is England, if that kind of makes sense. So you know, whilst we could sort of say that let's align ourselves with Europe and Wales, Northern Ireland, Scotland doing very similar things, it is important what England does, in both in terms of agricultural support and other regulatory changes. They are a major market, but they're also the biggest producers of agricultural commodities and products within the United Kingdom as well.
In terms of their export, then, would they then not be able to export to Europe if they use glyphosate?
It potentially. It all depends on where that would fit within the trade and cooperation agreement, which obviously at the moment is allowing continuous trade. But you know, if England and Europe were to diverge significantly, that might test the boundaries of that trade and cooperation agreement. But as the UK government, on behalf of England, I guess, has been saying a lot, is that, you know, they're seeking export opportunities beyond Europe. In 2021, we've seen an Australia free trade agreement being agreed. We've seen a New Zealand free trade agreement being agreed. So in many ways, I think England continue to focus on developing markets beyond Europe. For all sorts of other reasons other than agricultural, and are quite happy to accept imports from other agricultural economies, because the benefits of having a trade agreement with Australia and New Zealand isn't about farming or food, it's about financial services, tech, digital, all sorts of other things. So, you know, there are risk factors around some of these trade agreements that are well documented, certainly from our perspective. So I don't think that the UK government at this moment in time will be too concerned about the loss of markets, whether it's Europe or otherwise, for agricultural and food products.
Okay. I'm looking in the chat to see if any of my committee members have an additional question. There isn't one there at the moment, so I'm assuming we've all exhausted our thoughts on this morning. So again, Mr. Hall, thank you very much for your submission and your attendance at committee this morning. I'm going to suspend for 5 minutes or so and return at 10:10 to committee. On that note, I'll suspend the meeting. Thank you. Hello, and a very warm welcome back to our second agenda item this morning on the committee's inquiry into the Scottish Government's international work. I'm delighted to welcome to committee this morning Martin Johnson, EU Director of the Brussels Office of the Scottish Government, Dr. Alexandra Stein, Head of the Berlin Office, Scottish Government, and John Webster, Head of London Office of the Scottish Government. Thank you all for providing submissions prior to today's session, and I'm going to invite Mr. Johnson to make a brief opening statement. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, committee members. Thank you for the opportunity to give evidence today and to contribute to this inquiry. I think, you know, I can say we very much welcome the chance to speak with you today. It's the first time I think any of us have spoken to a Holyrood committee, and I think, as I say, we're very happy to do so. The written note which we provided to you earlier in the week ahead of the session sets out some factual information about the government's international network, our offices, the kind of work we do, the areas of focus which we have. I hope that was useful, and we're very happy to build on that through the session today. There were just three things I wanted to emphasise at this point. The clerks have warned me to be brief, so I will heed that. Firstly, I just want to say that I think, you know, the Scottish Government's overseas network of offices, and indeed colleagues at home doing international facing work, you know, is a highly committed, talented group of officials working, I think, incredibly hard to promote Scotland and Scottish interests, including showing real resilience over the last couple of years and the challenges. I think we're fortunate to have the team of people we do representing Scotland across the network. I think second, I would emphasise that while the UK's exit from the EU and the subsequent end of the Brexit transition period clearly creates a new context and new challenges, both for the EU office and for our European engagement more generally, I think Scottish ministers are absolutely committed to internationalism, to Scotland continuing to work with friends and partners in Europe and beyond. The programme for government published in September reaffirmed that commitment, while COP26 in Glasgow last month, I think, gave us a further sense of momentum and purpose, particularly, of course, on climate issues. I think, finally, I mentioned at the beginning our desire to support your inquiry. I'd also emphasise the real value that we see in it. Others who've given evidence have mentioned the importance of a greater focus on EU and international issues and the links to Scotland. Your work, including this inquiry, I think can really help with that. I know you're also considering how the committee might focus on these issues in the future, what further work you might do. I think, again, we'd welcome that, and we'd be happy to touch on those issues through the session today. I'll pause there. Thank you.
Thank you very much for those introductory remarks. We're going to move to questions from the committee shortly, and I would remind members, if they have a particular order they want witnesses to respond to, if they could say that when they ask their question. But if I could open, your written submission mentions that the international offices are grounded in Scotland's national performance framework. And I'd like you to elaborate on that, particularly with another aspect of our committee, is how that ties in with the Scottish Government's cultural priorities. And if we go to Mr. Johnson first, please, then Ms. Dr. Stein, and then Mr. Webster.
Thank you. I mean, I think in the note we drew attention in particular within the NPF to two of the outcomes, so the globally competitive, entrepreneurial, inclusive, sustainable economy, and then the being open, connected and making a positive contribution internationally. So obviously these are quite high level, but then we translate them into more detail through things like the business planning work, the five objectives for the international network, and then the specifics for each office. On the cultural linkage, I mean, I think this is an area that we're thinking a lot about at the moment. You'll be aware the Programme for Government has a commitment for a cultural diplomacy strategy, so me and colleagues are involved in thinking about the content of that. I think what I would say is, you know, the cultural activities that we do, whether it's in Brussels or elsewhere, and that's a range of celebrating, you know, national festivals or promoting Scottish music, literature, arts. You know, those are things which have a real purpose. You know, those are things which open conversations, make connections, promote Scotland in the widest sense, but also lead to really, I think, strong kind of diplomatic outcomes ultimately. You know, Scotland has a very, as you know, kind of well-recognised international sort of set of brands. I think that came through at COP again last month. I know there are questions about how we present a kind of modern, dynamic, innovative framing of that, but I think, you know, the inherent strength of Scotland's recognition abroad is something that is, you know, really valuable, really important. And, you know, if we have a Burns Supper, or if we have a St Andrews event, or if we promote the Scots language or the Gaelic language, and these are all things, you know, we do, you know, as part of our programme, you know, those have a real diplomatic purpose. Those are about building relationships that can then deliver in other spaces, as well as actually the cultural lens in themselves. And I think the cultural diplomacy strategy, that's the kind of territory it will be in. You know, how do we make that as strategic and focused and impactful as possible? But I do think the inherent strength of what we have to offer and the recognition of it is something which, you know, we should be very proud of and think about how we get the most from, but, you know, something that's really valuable to us.
Dr. Stein?
Yes, thank you very much. I think I would ask for Berlin and Germany. I would echo what Martin has just said, and maybe just give you a couple of examples from our side, so from the Germany approach. So I think within Germany, our work with culture and cultural diplomacy, there are two very, very clear approaches. So the first is that it is part of our soft diplomacy work, and therefore we use, for example, the events such as St Andrew's Nights or the concerts we hold to invite in political and economic contacts that we've made over the past while, and also to reaffirm relationships and to deepen relationships. So there, for example, in our latest Burns Supper, for example, SDI had two tables directly for their invited guests, and that's led to some that's helped very much on the trade and investment side. Linking also, for example, to an MOU with Hamburg on that. And then I think for the culture for its own sake, we've taken approach of, for example, with our concert series on Indigenous languages, of reflecting the Scottish Government's year of themes. Next year is going to be Year of Story, so we'll be reflecting that as well. In our first year, we were fortunate to have the European Championships between Glasgow and Berlin, and that was very much a focus of our cultural activities. We're also using that to promote intercity partnerships and partnerships that last a longer time. And then, for example, looking back at Burns, for example, we've also the last one we had in person because of COVID, we took the theme of Burns and nature to link into COP, which was due to be held that year. So we try to often take an angle or a theme to what we're doing. And I think there's also one more thing I'd say, and that is that we are also, unfortunately, we've just had to postpone our St Andrew's Day event, but we'll be taking this forward next year, is that we were going to use the St Andrew's Day event with an invited band, also to invite the music trade within Germany to the concert. And so we're working together to showcase Scotland on that. And the idea there is to work with Showcase Scotland to actually help Scottish bands make it into the German market and find agents. So agents are going to be invited to that as well. So we use culture in a vast array of ways, if you like.
Thank you. And finally, can I invite Mr. Webster?
Thank you, Convener. If I could make three points about how we engage with and use culture internationally. I think first it's important to talk about the enabling quality of culture. Second, the importance of upfront promotion of artists and our creative sector, almost viewing it as another part of our trade play, and its ability to start conversations. So if I could give a few examples of that, both from my time in Ireland and my 3 months that I've been the head of Scotland House London. I think back pre-pandemic to a project that the Scottish Government Office in Ireland under my leadership developed with a leading theatre group in Dublin, in inner city Dublin, that brought together school kids from inner city Glasgow with school kids from inner city Dublin to co-create works of poetry that talked about their problems, their issues, what it felt like to be a young person in place. And through that, starting conversations and links at the secondary education level. Another example would be a framework that office in Dublin is working on with the Museum of Literature Ireland, that is bringing together Scotland and Ireland to celebrate our literary heritage, in particular through our UNESCO Cities of Literature. And what that's going to do is it's going to provide a platform for Scottish artists, writers, performers travel to Dublin and put on works, lectures, talk about their work and collaborate with artists using the Museum of Literature Ireland as a platform in Dublin. And that ability to start conversations, I think, has to run through everything that we do. And going back to that first one, that enabling quality, what it does is it opens doors. It tells a story. It tells a story about who we are, what kind of country Scotland is, and it engages a broad diversity of audience. You know, the culture people don't just talk to culture people. Business people like culture as well, and it brings different people into a room to start those conversations.
Thank you. I'm going to move to questions from my committee members. Can I invite first Ms. Boyack, please?
Thank you very much, Convener. Can I also thank the witnesses for the evidence we've had in front of us this morning? It's been really, really useful. I'd like to follow up the issue we've been discussing for the last few weeks in our inquiry. We've had a lot of evidence in recent weeks about how we enable scrutiny of the Keeping Pace legislation alongside how we retain links across the EU. And there's been quite a focus in evidence we've had from witnesses about both intergovernment and interparliamentarian contacts, which was a very good session we had last week. And a key issue that come out is that to track what's happening, we need to keep an eye over about 1,000 pieces of legislation a year that come out of Europe. So I wanted to get a bit of reflection and maybe start with you, Mr. Johnson, about what's changed and how you operate. And how you're intending to actually communicate what's happening in Europe so that our businesses, our civic community and our parliamentarians and indeed the government can see what legislation is coming down the tracks at a European level and inform a discussion about where we do want to keep pace, where we don't want to keep pace, and to kind of have an informed discussion about the implications of potential EU legislation. Well, as I say, maybe Mr. Johnson first, how you'll assist us in that process of keeping pace, information and transparency and knowledge about that process.
Great, thank you. There's quite a lot there. I know you have a separate process running in terms of you know, receiving the draft statement and providing a report back. I know ministers are considering, you know, the detail of that, and we'll come back in the new year. I think just to try and work through that, I think, you know, starting with what's changed, obviously the reality is that we've left the EU and the transition period has now also ended, so we're outside the system. So we're not automatically plugged in the way that, you know, we were previously. And I think other witnesses have talked about how, you know, that has certain implications. You know, we're not in certain rooms, we're not in processes and structures, we don't have direct access to the information that we had before, and also we're not able to influence the development of legislation in the way that a member state would. So that's a significant change. I think for me and the team here, you know, that then creates new challenges around how do you build networks, how do you get good information, how do you plug into the places that you need to plug into, and to, you know, can we still exert influence? I think that last one's very difficult, but I think we should continue to look for opportunities. So what's changed in summary is, you know, we're on the outside and we need to do things a bit differently, but I think we feel we've got you know, we've got ways of continuing to be really effective. Just to say a bit on how my team then works with colleagues back in Edinburgh, I think the Brussels office role on alignment is to feed back into Scottish Government, probably in sort of two main things. I think one is helping ensure there's a real good sense of the strategic big picture. So a lot of what my team does is about reporting on latest developments. You know, we've got a Heads of State Council meeting happening right now. We had the Fit for 55 follow-up package of announcements earlier this week. You know, some really interesting and relevant stuff for Scotland. So the team here is providing information on that big picture through various channels. And then secondly, what we're doing here is engaging in specific areas to support colleagues. So if they need to know more about the Fit for 55 climate and environment package, you know, we can help conversations be set up. We can help clarifications of information. We can help those channels run. And if there are areas where there's legislation coming down the track that we might want to have a conversation about, and just to pick one example, you know, the EU is thinking a lot about hate crime legislation at the moment. That's an area that the Scottish Parliament has looked at, you know, in recent times. You know, that's an example of something where we might be able to go and have a conversation and say, this is our experience, you know, this may be of use. So I think that's about how the office here feeds into the overall system that is being built up to manage the process of taking forward ministers' commitments and ambitions on alignment. I think on your question about conveying what's happening to a wider group of stakeholders, including, you know, private sector and other actors, I think that is a really good question. I think we're still in the sort of relatively early stages of working through that. I think your committee has a role in both kind of stimulating discussion on that and kind of, you know, a challenge function. There's some really good work going on led in the team in DEXA in Edinburgh to take forward this area. But I think we do need to develop this. We do need to think about how we do it. What I'd say on the, you know, the committee's role, you mentioned the sheer volume of EU legislation. You know, it can be up sort of in the thousands once you take into account all the different instruments. You know, I think, you know, my feeling would be we're not in a world where we're going to be tracking every single item, many of which would not be relevant to Scotland. I think, you know, for the committee, it's the kind of strategic sort of overview and the sort of strategic questions. You know, what's the kind of big picture direction of travel? And questions like the ones you've asked about how information is on this is conveyed sort of more widely, I think that's the kind of valid question, as opposed to wanting necessarily to track every single item, which I think would be, you know, really difficult to do and not necessarily a good use of sort of time and resource. So those are just some observations. I hope that's helpful.
Yeah, that's very helpful. I mean, it was that issue, but how do you work out what is the most significant? Because there might be business interests who do think something's important, but it's not come through an initial track. So that was one of the things we were asking the Cabinet Secretary to look at. But I was thinking about your role in it as people who got those kind of contacts, and you've developed contacts over the years. Can I get Dr. Stein? You're in the Berlin office. How does it feel from your perspective? Because we had a German MEP involved in Europe, and it was very interesting getting his perspective on some of this last week. David McAllister, who's here, the EU Foreign Affairs Committee. Just to what extent do we track stuff in different offices, and to what extent does it come through the Brussels office? What's your particular role, and the role of offices like yourself across the EU?
Yep, thank you very much. So I think obviously things have changed partly because we are on the outside, and our interlocutors know that we're on the outside of the EU. But I think I'd say within that it's probably changed for us less than it has, say, for example, for the Brussels office, because when UK or Scotland's engaging with Germany as a member state of the EU, then everything does go through the Brussels office, really, and goes through the EU. And Germany has always been very, very clear about its loyalties as a member of a member state of the EU. So that will always take priority in Germany over the bilateral relationship. Having said that, we in any case seek to engage on matters of substance and matters where we have common bilateral interests, you know, whether that's around climate change or renewable energy or higher education. And so those conversations have very much carried on. We're still engaging on that, in some cases we're finding slightly different ways through it, but it's very much everything is about finding, you know, the positive way forward. I think the other thing I would say is that although Brexit's now been concluded, the door is very much open for us. You know, I think we find it very easy still to have all the conversations and to start the partnerships, and, you know, the willingness to engage and to find new ways of doing things is certainly there.
Okay, thanks. And one of the issues that came up last week was about the need for better relationships in those UK offices that are based in different parts of the EU. I don't know if that's a question for who'd be best to answer that, Mr. Webster or Mr. Johnson, about how we make better use of existing links, given that changes have taken place are very significant.
Yeah, I'm happy to go first. I'm sure Martin will have a sense of that as well. Listen, I would concur with what both my colleagues Alexandra and Martin have said. One of the significant changes post-exit from the EU is that we have to pedal harder to make these links meaningful. But that doesn't mean to say it's impossible. You have to find other ways to do it, sometimes lateral. But it is possible, and as Alexandra has said, the doors remain open. In the course of what I do in London, I of course engage on a day-to-day basis and every day with overseas embassies through the normal course of the diplomatic circuit. A priority for me is to engage with EU embassies to maintain those links. And one of the important aspects of an effective diplomatic network or international network is that you coordinate both in terms of your inputs and your outputs. So understanding what information you're looking for and is important, and making sure that your reporting goes to the right people across that network so that we are all informed and we can all be speaking with one voice and working to a kind of overall strategy in terms of what we're looking for is important. In terms of how we use existing links, and I think what you were asking there is how we interact UK partners on those platforms that we share with the UK. Look, I'm sure we'll get into this later in the conversation, but the most relevant experience I have on this is my 4 and some years of working on the British Embassy platform in Dublin as the head of the Scottish Government office there. And what I can say is that relationships on that platform were excellent. There was a real sense from the UK ambassador and his team of the complementarity of what we both do. There was a real sense that the Scottish Government being on platform allowed a more complete and holistic picture and story to be told about what Scotland offers in Ireland and the doors that that opens. I would say there's work to be done about how we share information on the discussions we have with government in countries. Some of that is sensitive. Some of that the UK government will be reluctant to share its sensitive diplomatic reporting, and we have to respect that. But those personal relationships on these British embassy platforms and the quality of those relationships are a means through which we will improve our sense of that picture, I think.
Thanks, that's very useful. And Mr. Johnson, finally, I'm just thinking about how you make that effective in terms of sharing access to information that would be useful for stakeholders in Scotland but in other parts of the UK as well.
Yeah, thank you. I was just going to build first, if it's okay, on John's point on interaction with UK colleagues.
Yeah.
If that's okay, I think I would just echo and build a little on what John said, I think, you know, in Brussels we're unusual. We have our own premises. You know, it's essentially around the corner from the UK mission. I think we have, you know, strong links with UK mission colleagues. We do work collaboratively on a number of areas. I mean, to give you examples of sort of topics recently, you know, the preparation for COP in Glasgow and the delivery of that, I think there was, you know, a lot of constructive dialogue around that. I think the COVID situation over the last 18 months, there's been quite a number of areas where we've worked together to promote Scottish interests, but in a way that added value. So if you think of something like the digital COVID certificates and how they interact with QR codes in England and Scotland, a really complicated issue that, you know, some of my team have been very involved with. And then even specific things, I'm thinking back to last year when the Scottish National Investment Bank needed state aid clearance in order to be established. Again, that was an area where there was a lot of positive working. So I think that complementarity in those kind of areas is there. I think, you know, there is, it is important we're able to act in order to promote Scottish ministerial interests. So there'll be areas where we will, you know, have our own dialogue and our own connections. And of course, that's an important part of what we do. But I think, you know, generally we would be transparent about that and, you know, share information in a way that is helpful, you know, but with always having Scottish interests, I think, and our minister's interests in mind. But I think there's lots of opportunity to do things collaboratively and in ways that kind of build and get extra value. In terms of, sorry, do you mind just on the question of how that relates back into stakeholders back in Scotland? Do you mind just coming back on that question, and I will.
Yeah, just a final thought in terms of how you communicate, how you do that with stakeholders in Scotland. I mean, obviously you've mentioned COVID being a challenge, but on another level, it's made everybody digitally connected. Are there opportunities that you can see going forward to that to be more effective?
I think so. I mean, it's one of the ironies of the pandemic. I think, you know, a big feature of what we do in Brussels is running events. So we've put that online, obviously, in the last 18 months. What that allows you to do at times, though, is actually bring together, perhaps more easily than would otherwise be the case, you know, really kind of interesting groups of senior stakeholders on different topics. And I think, you know, that's been something that we need to take some learning from into the future. And it may be that, you know, some of the events will continue to be online going forward, because, you know, we are able to bring together senior EU figures, you know, people from Scotland, potentially, you know, others beyond Europe into really interesting discussions. I think in terms of communication, I mean, we, from our office here, have a number of regular channels of communication. We do a regular note back into SG each week. Our Scotland Europa colleagues in Brussels obviously provide very regular briefings and information to their members. We use, you know, webcasts and other sessions to update people at particular set piece moments, whether it's things like the Fit for 55 package or the State of the Union speech by the Commission or the Commission work programme. You know, we'll use a mix of online and kind of written briefings to do that. So I think we've probably ramped that up a bit over the last 18 months, just because those are the channels that have been available. But I think, you know, those are effective, and you know, there's quite a wide audience for some of those sessions.
Okay, thanks very much. Thanks, Convener.
Can I invite Mr. Cameron, please?
Thank you, Convener. I just wanted to ask Dr. Stein about interaction with the UK government diplomatic effort in Germany. Just because the other two witnesses have spoken about this, I wanted to give you the opportunity to make any comments on that, please.
Yes, thank you very much. I'm more than happy to do that. So I think probably first of all, there's a clear programme of sharing information. There's a rhythm, if you like, of information sharing meetings, whether they're with the the regular embassy calls, or whether in particular areas such as public health or climate or energy, where we think that Scotland has particular interests within the embassy. We also collaborate on certain events. So, for example, the spring reception, we will make our contributions to that. And the last one that was able to be held in person was again before COP, and where the Italian ambassador was invited. And we made a presentation to him, for example, of the COP tartan. So we make our contributions there, and we also hold, or so far we've held our Burn Suppers jointly with the ambassador. So the ambassador and I have jointly hosted those events. There are also other areas where, for example, we've helped provide speakers. So, for example, earlier this year, the embassy was organising an information workshop on the Under 2 Coalition, and we felt that it was more than appropriate, given that Scotland had taken over the European co-chairmanship of the coalition, that we should be part of the panel. And we were duly represented on that panel as partners, and made main presentations, and then followed up with individual states within Germany, who then expressed interest in joining that coalition. And then I suppose in another area is about promoting understanding of devolved issues, and also where people may just not be aware, for example, that if, for example, we're engaging on youth exchange or language learning, that where Germany or the embassy is engaging with the DfE, then Scotland also has, the Scottish Government also has an interest because education policy has devolved, for example. So there's a lot of information sharing is seeking to contribute.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Dr. Allen?
Thank you, Convener. A question perhaps firstly for John Webster, or for John Webster. There are, as everyone knows, there's differing models of Scotland's representation around the world, from the SDI offices to co-location, as you've described, with embassies and UK embassies, that is. But Scotland House, as a distinctive model, obviously operating on its own premises and on its own terms. I wonder if you could say a bit more about some of the things that are distinctive about Scotland House, and particularly, I know, the efforts that have certainly been made pre-pandemic to bring businesses into the building and have a kind of open door.
Yeah, of course, Mr. Allen, it's a great question. I've got experience of working on both a Scottish Government office on a shared platform with a British embassy, and now in Scotland House, London. I think broadly, in terms of behaviour and methodology, we're talking about the same thing. But the distinction you've alighted on is perhaps the clearest one. The Scotland House, London model is interesting. I'd say it is unique. I've never in my 35-year career in diplomacy seen an innovative model like it. And in fact, in London, just in the last couple of months, I've had visits from a couple of London-based embassies who are looking at that model as one that they might like to follow in their international network, or indeed as they reshape their presence in London. And I'm due to have a visit from the Spanish ambassador early in the new year for exactly the same purpose. You talked about inviting businesses onto the platform. Scotland House London really is split into two distinct functions on the same platform. It has an intergovernmental partnership through which Scottish Government works with contributory partners, SDI, Scottish Enterprise, Highlands and Islands Enterprise, and Visit Scotland. And we hope to add to that partnership model with other agencies in Scotland in the new year. And we have a business hub, which offers membership services to Scottish businesses, but not just Scottish businesses. Scottish universities, innovation centres are members of Scotland House London. They can subscribe through a membership model, and for that subscription, they effectively get a very top class serviced office. They get a networking space, a boardroom facility, an event space. And they get the opportunity to interact with government and agencies and get our support for what they are doing on our platform. It also gives us the opportunity to run events with members that create a community of practice, which enables us to tell a more holistic story about who we are and what kind of Scotland, what kind of country Scotland is today. And it enables us to attract a more diverse set of audiences who, were we just doing this as government alone, may not be as attracted to the platform. So I think it's an interesting model. It is in its infancy. Scotland House London only had maybe 1.5 years of full operation before the pandemic struck, during which time the model had to be mothballed for public health reasons, very, very good and important public health reasons. We reopened in September, ran up until last week when we had to pause again for public health reasons as Omicron started to rise rapidly. And I hope that we'll reopen full services again in the new year as soon as we can. It's an exciting model, and it's one that I think offers huge potential both for Scottish business, for the Scottish economy and one of its most important markets, but also really interesting potential for creating new and interesting collaborations across the range of activity that we seek to pursue under the National Performance Framework.
Thank you. Question for Dr. Stein and Mr. Johnson. I think you both talked about cultural diplomacy and soft power, and I think rightly you've been careful not to draw too fine a distinction or too complete a distinction between art for art's sake, as it were, and culture with diplomacy in mind. I think it's right not to draw that distinction too sharply. But in terms of the work that is being done to promote Scotland's culture overseas, I wonder, could you say a bit more about what the aims of that is? I mean, specifically, you mentioned literature. I'm just curious to know what the aims were in mind, if there were cultural aims specifically.
I'm happy to come in on that. So I think a couple of the examples I've given, we do want to promote Scottish culture as Scottish culture. And for example, whenever we hold a Burn Supper or St Andrew's Night event, we will bring in a Scottish band for the music. And we also, well, pre-COVID times, we would also host a Ceilidh, for example. And that is very much about inviting people in, showcasing Scottish culture and actually letting people really experience and enjoy it. Because one of the comments that came after our first St Andrew's Night event, and this was actually from a journalist, was that it was the best event in the diplomatic calendar. You know, we'd come brand new to Berlin and we really had an impact very, very quickly with that. And everything that's around it. So the other thing that we aim to do, for example, is we bring the band in, but we also bring the best of Scottish food and drink across as well. So I think one of your other contributors earlier had said, there's a comment about the perception of Scottish food and drink. So we aim to bring the best of Scottish whiskey, of gin, of fish, produce. I mean, we aim to sort of showcase that as well, and got uses of excellent chefs locally. And then the other thing we did last time, because we were also thinking about sustainability, was also we had a Scotland meets Brandenburg. So we brought in the best of Scottish produce that we could, but we also said that for everything else, we will make sure that we source locally grown produce. And so we had that, and that way we brought together Scotland with the immediate state, you know, the state surrounding Berlin, Brandenburg. So there was a deliberate policy through that. The other thing is on literature, for example, 2019, we partnered with a literature festival in Rheinland-Pfalz, which is now our key cultural and higher education partner within Germany. And we brought over 6 Scottish poets for a week, a translation workshop for a week, together with 6 German poets. And out of that came a book that's now been published and has also been showcased on national radio as well. So we aim to get a wide reach. And so through that project, for example, people could read the poetry in the original Scots, in the original Gaelic, and in the original English and the German, all within the same volume. So it's very much about trying to bring that to German audiences, bring it to new German audiences who may not have come across that before, and just open that door to Scotland. And we're trying to do that throughout Germany. For example, in Hamburg, we also partnered with the British Council for a poetry event last year as well. Again, the same purpose, but it's about showcasing Scottish culture within Germany.
Thank you. And finally, Mr. Johnson, you've described how you have to operate in the Brussels office in a post-Brexit landscape. Last week, as was alluded to in committee, we were speaking to David McAllister about the European Parliament, and for very understandable and sound reasons, he was keen to indicate that relationships between the European Parliament and our Parliament would have to be informal rather than formal. But I take it you're still operating in both informal and formal spheres.
Thank you. I think, you know, that's exactly right. I mean, I think there's been, you've heard evidence, I think, about the Friends of Scotland MEPs group. I mean, in terms of a structure that we've set up since EU exit almost a couple of years ago, you know, that group was set up, and that I think is a very effective mechanism for us to engage with what is quite a wide group of MEPs from all kind of political backgrounds. Generally, who have an interest in Scotland, but you know that allows us to create a dialogue and a way for ministers to engage, a way for us to have connectivity into things like the development of the policy agenda, which links back into alignment. And you know that group is public, as many of the friends groups with the Parliament are. You know, the UK has a friends group, but it also allows informal discussion and dialogue to happen. And again, it allows us to home in on specific policy areas and get access to, whether it's directly to Friends of Scotland MEP members or indeed other members of the Parliament that they can connect us with. So I think that's a key focus of the work in Brussels as it relates into the Parliament. I think there's I know David McAllister was touching on some wider issues about the relationship between, as you touched on, the Parliament and the Scottish Parliament, and the need to have formal links with, you know, national parliaments. But I think he also touched on the question of the Parliamentary Partnership Assembly, which, you know, as part of the Trade and Cooperation Agreement architecture. You know, I think the EU have now constituted their membership of their side of that agreement. The UK side, I think, is still to be confirmed. You know, there's a question there about the role of the Scottish Parliament in terms of feeding into that structure. And, you know, that is a formal structure that I think is really of interest and is significant. So I think if there's links that can be built from Scotland into that structure, again, that's a formal mechanism, which in terms of TCA governance is really important. And I think, you know, I would hope there'd be a good and appropriate Scottish voice in that structure on the UK side.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you. I'm now at that time on a Thursday morning where I have to say to everyone we're pushing up against time, so if people could be succinct in their questions and answers, and only answer if you really feel you've got something to add to what's been said, unfortunately. It's the nature of FMQs on a Thursday for us. Can I invite Mr. Golden, please?
Thank you, convener, and I'll keep it to one question to meet the time requirements, and I'll start with Mr. Johnson, if that's okay, but the same question to the entire panel. I was just wondering how success is measured in your office, what metrics you use, and whether you feel that they are appropriate.
Thank you, Mr. Golden. I think you know, I will just say a bit, and colleagues can maybe add some detail. I think the starting point for the international network is 5 outcomes. So reputation, businesses trading internationally more effectively, research and innovation capability promoted, and partnerships and funding secured, investment into Scotland, and then the final one is Scotland's interest in the EU and beyond are protected and enhanced. Now, those, as you'll see, are inherently quite high level, but that's the kind of starting point, not just for the Brussels office, but for the other overseas offices. Those are then converted into business plans in each of the offices, and those business plans over the last 2 or 3 years have increasingly been developed as joint SDI, Scottish Government products, or Scotland Europa, Scottish Government in the Brussels context. So those then generate more specific objectives and aims, and then at the end of each reporting year, each of the offices produces an evaluation report, which is fed back in centrally to the colleagues in the Directorate for External Affairs and the international board that sits above. Just building on that specifically, you know, what are the kind of things that are measurable? I mean, clearly, you know, economic and other forms of diplomacy by their nature are quite difficult to measure. Some of the things that they deliver are inherently sort of medium or longer term. And things like reputation and enhancement of reputation, and going back to what Alexandra was saying about cultural events, again, it is quite hard to measure. But I think the kind of things we do try and measure, and this is a sort of evolving area where we're kind of improving it as we go, you know, the volume of senior ministerial engagements, you know, the number of events that we promote, the kind of participation either directly in those events or in terms of the audience, the social media footprint and how that grows, and also the nature of it. And then on the trading and economic front, you know, specifically, are there investments or outcomes we can point to? That's more, if you like, in an SDI space, that kind of hard economic measurement. But, you know, I think that's something we should be alive to as a network. So what I would say is this is an evolving area. I think there have been good steps made on it in the last 2 or 3 years in the time I've been here. But, you know, it's a legitimate area, I think, for you and colleagues to look at and potentially sort of contribute thoughts, I think, on, you know, how do you do this? It's a very difficult area. You know, colleagues will say a bit more on the detail, but I think it's something we're working hard to try and improve on and develop, and we've made some good strides, I think.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. That's very helpful. I think we'll move to Germany next, and I'm keen to hear the thoughts of Dr. Stein.
Yep. So I would echo what Martin said as regards to the overall approach. The same approach goes for all of us, and we both do our business plan together, and we also do our monitoring and evaluation together as well. So they come into a joint report. We also work very, very closely with SDI in country on all of this as well. So I guess because some of the things are difficult or challenging to measure in their own right, we'll often look for proxies. So for example, hydrogen is a big topic for us in Germany at the moment. So we would be looking to count, for example, the number of events that we've spoken at, the number of ministerial speeches, the number of speeches I've given in German, for example, or which partners we brought in from Scotland to showcase them to the wider audience, and then also the outreach of some of the events. So, for example, I think we spoke last year at the German National Assembly on hydrogen. There were 3,500 attendees at that. We also did a mission hydrogen workshop with the energy minister speaking, and then we hosted a workshop. There were 10,000 registrations at that, and we think about 8,000 people attended. So we try and measure that sort of thing, and then we also look at media coverage, coverage of interviews that we've given, for example. We look at social media as well, how people are responding. We also look at the follow-up where people write into us after events. So often after, you know, giving a speech on a platform, people will follow up and ask for contact, and then we'll follow that contact through, and that will often lead to business contacts as well. So there's a combination between hard numbers and proxies and then narrative as well, where we try and follow something through.
Thank you, Dr. Stein. And now to London, and I feel like I'm on the Eurovision Song Contest, and Mr. Webster, keen for your thoughts.
I hope you're not going to say no point, Mr. Gold. Listen, if I can, I'll speak also from the perspective of Dublin. My colleagues have said it all. Actually, I've got an easy gig here. I'll make a couple of points, and that is to reinforce the integrated nature of the business planning model that we now use, certainly in Ireland. And in Scotland House London, we have one plan that includes the objectives of partners on Scotland House London, and it was a joint plan between Scottish Government and SDI. That leads to a shared action plan for how we pursue those objectives, and a shared evaluation report at the end of the year. Second point I'll make is that we also use survey tools. So, as well as the quantitative element of how many people you are bringing into your office or having meetings with, or having at receptions. We would, for example, in Ireland, survey people who came to our events, ask them questions about the impression that they left with of Scotland, the quality of speakers, or the experience, and from that gain a sense of what impression we were making on our key target stakeholders and audiences. We're doing a very similar thing, just about to launch a survey of members of Scotland House London, which will do two things. Retrospectively, it will ask them for their impressions of the quality of service that they receive and the links and the outputs that come from them from joining Scotland House London, but we'll also poll them on what they are looking for in this slightly changed reality that we are emerging into as we come out of the pandemic, so that we can properly assess need and tweak or recalibrate our offer to businesses on Scotland House London. The third point I'll make is that looking back and thinking about this in the context of both FCO and DFID, where I have extensive experience, our business planning process stands up to scrutiny. It's rigorous, and it really does read across quite favourably to those that are operated in embassies by the FCO and DFID's overseas network. So I think always room to improve. My colleagues have talked about the difficulty of developing quantitative measures for what are effectively long-term qualitative processes, for example, influence. But I think there are ways that you can improve, and I look forward to engaging with colleagues and making sure that we do that year on year. It's important.
Thank you, panel. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Can I move to Ms. Mintle, please?
Thank you, convener, and thank you, panel. This has been really informative, almost an hour, I think, of conversation. I was really interested there what you were saying, Mr. Webster, about the perception of Scotland and how you're actually recording that. And I wonder if perhaps you could expand a bit more on that. But I'm also interested to hear about the future plans that the Scottish Government has for expansion of the network of Scotland offices within Europe, so Copenhagen and also Warsaw. And also, if any of you can comment on the wider network of offices across the world that Scotland has. Thank you.
I mean, really interesting questions. I'm sure there could be a separate parliamentary evidence session on that question of international perceptions and branding. And I know that Murray Pittock talked a bit about this in his evidence session with you. How we did it in Ireland was to use surveys in a very targeted, sharply targeted way, to ask people about impressions of, in a very general sense, where we had thematically specific events, to ask what people had learned, and to use that evidence to feed the narrative in our end of year evaluation reports. And what we also did in Ireland was very carefully and closely look at the press and media about the kind of coverage that Scotland was getting in the Irish media, and to use that again as a very loose proxy, I think, for impressions. But it is, I think, an evolving science. I think there's a lot of work out there on international impressions. I think Scotland probably has room to grow and improve on that, and I think this network has a role to play in that. In terms of network expansion, I mean, I'm sure my colleagues will say more about this, but in the year to come in 2022, and I think into 2023, there are plans to open up an office in Copenhagen. And then one in Warsaw. I'm less sure about the timeline for Warsaw. I think the office in Copenhagen is a really exciting development. It's a fantastic job for a diplomat. The Nordic group of countries are a group with which we have much to collaborate on. I personally hosted a dinner a couple of months ago with the group of Nordic and Baltic ambassadors, and what struck me and that was not only the warmth but the degree to which substance bigger than that conversation, for example, Norway, really clear on the degree to which cooperation around our coastal economies is really important to them, and the scope there is to grow that cooperation and collaboration, and of course across that piece, the degree to which we can continue to exchange knowledge and technical expertise as we grow our renewable sector. So this is about developing friendship and collaboration, but it's also about real hard cooperation for economic benefit, mutual economic benefit. I'll leave it at that and let my colleagues say a few words.
If I can just quickly come in, I mean, thank you for that. Similarly, I had a meeting with some designers, young Scots designers, and it was this whole thing about cooperation and collaboration and the whole idea that perhaps we're a Southern Nordic state as opposed to a Northern European state. So I reflect positively on what you've just said. So thank you very much. I think Mr. Johnson is going to come in with regards to the expansion.
I will do. Thank you. Just to add a little bit, I think, to what John said on expansion. You know, on Copenhagen, the plan is to open the office next year. You know, the background to that, I think, is just a sense that it's a really good base, not just for Denmark, but for wider Nordic interests. And I think, you know, there are lots of connections with Nordic countries and lots of shared challenges. I think also the trading connections are really significant, the volume of trade and the potential there. And also we have an existing SDI presence. So there's something, and this goes back to kind of cost efficiency, you know, there's something about building on that. But I think for all those reasons, that one's, you know, as per the programme for government, you know, that's sort of the next one that's coming. On Warsaw, the commitment is to open an office in Warsaw before the end of the parliamentary session. So that's slightly further away time-wise. I think, you know, the rationale for that really is about the kind of educational, trade, cultural and other links that Scotland has with Poland. There's also a kind of regional dimension. I think, you know, this is an opportunity not just to engage with Poland, but actually kind of neighbouring countries. But I mean, what I would say, though, specifically on Poland is I think you know, Poland is a very significant player within the EU, you know, as a population of almost 40 million. I think it's the fifth largest member state. And, you know, it's a significant, you know, connection to be making and, you know, links to build. So I think, you know, there's a logic to that. I think on your other question about the wider network, I think I was reminding myself of the SDI network. You'll be aware it's bigger than the Scottish mm-hmm. government. I think it's something like 32 offices, but you know there are 6 in the Americas, 10 in Asia and Pacific, 2 in the Middle East, and then a whole set in Europe, many of which are co-location with the government offices. So what you've got there is quite a kind of global network. I think for us as officials over the last year or two, there's been a lot of work to build the connections that we have with the leaders of those offices. So you have something called the International Leaders Forum, where we meet up, albeit virtually recently. So, I mean, we've been building these connections actually and talking with colleagues in places like China in a way that, you know, we haven't done, I think, in years gone by. So there's some really interesting relationships developing, opportunities developing. You know, clearly there's a strategic question for ministers about the future of the Scottish Government network and what they want that footprint to look like. And it was interesting looking at the different manifestos on that going back to the election time. But, you know, that is, you know, an interesting strategic question as we go forward. But for me, the interaction with that SDI network is at the heart of that, because there's already that footprint there. And when you put the two things together and make them work effectively, you've got quite a kind of, I think, sort of impactful sort of proposition there. So, look, I hope that's helpful, but that's a few thoughts on that.
Very, very helpful, Mr. Johnson. Thank you. I think, convener, will I hand back to you?
Thank you very much, Ms. Minto. Yes. I could invite Mr. Ruskell, please.
Yeah, thanks, convener. Really interesting session. I was struck by what you're saying, Mr. Johnson about, you know, Fit for 55 and the EU's energy and climate package, and I think Dr. Steen, you were also talking about the work on hydrogen. I'm just interested just to unpack that just a little bit more as to what you see those, because it is such a big, you know, strategic priority, obviously, and it will dominate, I imagine, a lot of the work with the Copenhagen office. But what do you see as the main kind of work strands that are coming out of that? And I suppose the question is, you know, do you see Scotland at the moment as being aligned with that EU agenda, or are there perhaps differences in approach? You maybe start with Mr. Johnson on that one, please.
Thank you. Yeah, look, it's a really timely question as well. I mentioned at the beginning that you know the bulk of the Fit for 55 package of legislative proposals were published back in the summer. But, you know, just a couple of days ago, I think on Tuesday, there was a second package that the Commission put out. And just to give you some examples of why it's important, I think the package this week, for example, there was a lot in there on hydrogen, definitions for different types of hydrogen, proposals for rules around how hydrogen networks will operate in the EU for the transportation of hydrogen. And then there were additional proposals on things like the energy performance of buildings. And if you look at the whole package, including the proposals that came out in the summer, you know, you have areas like renewable energy, energy efficiency, emissions trading, vehicle standards. You know, these are all things that have real sort of resonance and relevance to Scotland. The bulk of them are in devolved areas. And if you go back to something like hydrogen, and I'm sure Alexandra will build on this, you know, for us, understanding what's happening in a kind of regulatory space in the EU is just really significant. As we look at things like the Hydrogen Action Plan that was published last month, you know, a big part of that strategy is generating enough renewable hydrogen that Scotland can be an exporter of that. And the EU is a really significant potential market, certainly, you know, neighbouring, you know, the closest, physically closest member states in particular. And that question of the EU importing, you know, renewable hydrogen was actually something the Commission President von der Leyen spoke specifically about 2 weeks ago when she launched the Global Gateway strategy. So you've got a kind of economic driver there. You've got an environmental and sustainability driver. And then you've got the question of alignment. And just to go back to that question, you know, Scotland is very aligned across these areas. Now, partly that's a function of having had the same legislation because we were a member state and bound by EU rules until very recently. But, you know, the ministerial ambition is, as we know, to stay aligned across these areas. And if you look at things like, you know, take an example like single-use plastics and the policy and the plans on that, you know, that would be a really good example of something where, you know, what we're doing in Scotland is very much aligned with EU plans. So I think across the piece, you've got a really interesting, significant package. It's the centrepiece of the Commission's work programme along with digital, and not just kind of in terms of policy outcomes and high standards and high protections, actually on economic issues like growing the hydrogen sector and potentially exporting, you know, really significant too. So lots of stuff there. I'll pause there.
Yeah. Okay. I know time's getting on, but I just had a further question that was in relation to the COP presidency. I mean, you touched earlier on a lot of preparatory work that obviously you were involved with that. But, you know, we've still got some time left in that COP presidency until next year when it hands over. So I'm interested in what that work stream looks like at the moment.
I'm looking for someone to self-nominate to come in on that.
I can come in on that.
Thank you.
The first thing to say is that is a really good question. I mean, you're quite right, the UK presidency runs until I think it's around the summer before handing on ahead of you know, COP27, which is going to be in Egypt. The main focus, I think, is driving forward the momentum of COP, trying to drive up ambition and trying to make sure that when nationally determined contribution plans are updated at COP27, that you know, the ambition level is lifted. So I think there's a role on the one hand for Scotland in supporting that drive, but I think what also came through at COP was some very distinct areas of Scottish interest and leadership, things like the statement on women's leadership on climate issues, the question of loss and damage, the question of the dialogue with the Global South, as well as the promotion of Scotland's own very progressive and extensive kind of framework of legislation and ambitions. So I think, to me, there's two tracks. There's both supporting the thrust of what the presidency is trying to achieve in the run-up to COP27, and then also alongside that, a very distinct and strongly value-adding platform of things Scotland, you know, pushed very successfully around COP, the kind of things I've mentioned. So that gives a sense. I hope that's helpful. That gives a sense of what I would see as kind of two tracks there.
Yeah. I see that Dr. Stein would like to come in as well.
Yeah, no, I'm happy to come in and sorry, thank you very much. Happy to come in and actually offer additional evidence on both questions. So I think on the question of COP, it's an example of where so much of our work and so many of our priorities are actually interrelated. So we'll be taking forward the work on COP through our engagement around hydrogen, for example, or biodiversity, because those are core themes that will underline all our work going forward. And by taking that forward, we also contribute to the COP programme as well. And indeed, we're already in the process of planning follow-up engagement around the various themes of COP, which I suppose takes me back to hydrogen. You were asking about hydrogen in Germany. I mean, this has been a key priority for us for about 18 months, and actually, the roots really lie in the German presidency as well. So back in summer 2020, Germany published its hydrogen action, hydrogen strategy, followed by the EU a month later. And quite clearly, Germany was positioning the EU, and it said, we are going to lead the hydrogen agenda for Europe, and we're going to coordinate Europe's hydrogen agenda. And they also stated, for example, that Germany wants to be the global leader in hydrogen technologies. But at the same time, they have requirements for massive amounts. They want to, you know, they need to import massive industrial scale amounts of green hydrogen. If you link this back to our hydrogen strategy, which was published last December in the action plan, you know, we're positioning Scotland in Germany as being one of Germany's key import countries. So we're using the fact, for example, that, you know, Scotland's got 25% of the wind resources in Europe. We are also building on the fact that, for example, Scotland has a, you know, a 10-15 year of learning by doing in the areas of green hydrogen. So where Germany's saying that it wants to import 90 to 110 terawatt hours of green hydrogen a year, and Scotland's most ambitious scenario says we might be able to export 94 terawatt hours of green hydrogen a year. You know, we're saying, you know, you're looking to South Africa, you're looking to Australia, you're looking to Chile, Scotland's just over the waters. We're a stable provider, and that we want to be part of the portfolio of import countries. So I guess what we're doing there is we're looking to get onto national platforms. We're engaging with key trade associations across Germany. We're speaking to to organisations such as the Chambers of Commerce in Germany. We're engaging with the media. We're building MOUs between the deep wind cluster in Scotland and the offshore wind cluster in Germany. And we've also building MOUs with key states within Germany all around the topic of hydrogen. So we're really looking forward to take that forward as a key priority. And the Hamburg MOU, for example, was signed just 3-4 weeks ago, is actually about how we build import-export technologies together. So part of it is about import-export, and part of it's also about how Germany and Scotland work together on their common interest to develop the hydrogen economy more quickly. Because in Scotland, we said this could be worth as much as £25 billion per year by 2045 and 300,000 jobs. So it's a key opportunity that we have to pursue, but we'll only realise that if we have a good export market. So it's bringing everything together around that.
Thanks. I'd love to do another hour on that, but I don't know.
Okay. I'm sure. Mr. Cameron, very quickly, sorry.
I've got lots of questions, but I'll only ask one. I just want to get your sense, as you look at the entire sort of international office presence across the world, whether you think we are in the right places, I suppose, is the question. And I say that having listened to the justification for the new offices in Copenhagen and Warsaw, and you know, I don't want to refight old battles. Brexit has happened. We've left the EU, and notwithstanding all of that, you know, we seem to be opening further offices in the EU. And I just wonder whether you think that's right, whether we're not in, for example, Australia or New Zealand, we're not in Africa, we're not in South America. And I just wonder, it's just a very general question as to whether you think we are correctly positioned. And could I go to Mr. Webster, first of all?
Are we correctly positioned? Drawing on my experience working in the UK Embassy Network, working on trade teams, and having recently worked in Ireland, I've yet to see much compelling evidence that suggests to me that the countries do not trade most effectively and in highest volume in their immediate neighbourhood. So I think, from a trade perspective, in or out of the EU, there is still a real national interest in having the kind of presence in our near neighbourhood that can support that that set of trading relationships. When it comes to wider international, should we be in Australia and New Zealand? I'm sure there would be very compelling reasons that we could develop relationships, historical none, to begin with. I'm sure my ministers would love that we had the capability and the resources to do so. But I think from a personal perspective, based on my own experience, when it comes to the deployment of limited resources, looking to a near neighbourhood makes a lot of sense from an economic and a trading perspective.
Dr. Stein?
Succinct answers, please, if possible. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you very much. I think I can probably really answer primarily only for Germany, because that's where I am. And I think what I'd say there is that Germany is the largest economy within Europe. It's Scotland's second most important trading and inward investment nation. It's also our top partner for higher education research collaboration, and a priority country for visitors and tourism. So on those grounds, I would say Germany is definitely the right country to be.
And Mr. Johnson.
Thank you. I mean, just to add a couple of thoughts. I think there's a question here about whether you're looking through a trade and economic development lens or a kind of diplomatic influencing lens. And the answer may be different, I think, depending on which lens it is. I mentioned earlier the SDI network, which is extensive globally and beyond Europe. So again, it comes back to that join up question and getting kind of some of the synergies. You know, I think this is a legitimate question for ministers to be reflecting on. It's also a dynamic question. It will evolve over time. We've got things like the Global Affairs Framework that's being developed for publication next year. So, and we had the trade vision that was published earlier this year. So I think, you know, these are areas that ministers are actively reflecting on, and these publications kind of shed light on this. But I mean, for me, I'd echo kind of some of what John said about economic connections, but it's clearly something that is dynamic and we will keep, quite rightly, I think, coming back to, you know, as we go forward.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. And thank you to my committee members. This morning, it's obvious that this has opened a number of areas that maybe further discussion would be helpful on. I'm going to, from my own point of view, I think even understand the scope of the number of memorandums that are in place, memorandums of understanding that have been mentioned both at country, but also at city level. So it may be that we might write to you for some further information. I'm going to ask my committee members to reflect on the questions we didn't quite get to today. As Mr. Johnson said, it's the first time any committee has looked at these issues, and I'm sure it won't be the last. It's been a fantastic evidence session, and I thank you all for your attendance this morning. This is the final meeting of 2021, and I'd like to take the opportunity to put on record my thanks to our clerks, to Spice and the other members of the Parliament team who supported the committee since we came back for this session of the Parliament, and wish you all a very safe and hopefully happy festive period. Thank you very much. I'll close the meeting.